What's up, everybody? Welcome to the world's first Pete exclusive episode of Pete's Basement. It's going to be a wild time because we're going to talk about the Captain America statue dedication in Prospect Park. We're going to talk about me getting to meet Dave Cortez, the actual sculptor of the Captain America statue. We got a nice interview with him that you can catch on Pete's Basement Extras. We're going to talk about Neverland, number one from 451. We got Action Labs, Blue Hour, and Blood and Dust. We got DC's All-Star Batman by Scott Snyder and John Romita Jr. Deathstroke Rebirth and Red Hood and the Outlaws. We got Superwoman and Marvel's The Accused. We're also going to talk about CGC, CBCS. We got this really awesome Power Master Optimus Prime that I picked up from Midtown Comics. We got three of the four of Series 1 Super 7's Masters of the Universe, which I am actually going to leave carded because the artwork from Jason Edmiston is just way too awesome to damage. Pour yourself some whiskey, watch the intro, and I'll be right back. Here we go, guys. This is exclusively for you crazy bastards watching us on Periscope right now. I have said it in several past episodes. You've seen me drink it.
I already got it.
No, it's not Jameson.
No?
No, it's not Jameson.
Oh, it's full.
Jameson is my shooting whiskey. If I'm out at a bar, I'm shooting Jameson. I'm shooting Irish whiskey. But it is not, by a long shot, my favorite. So if anybody out there happens to know my exact favorite brand and age, we have to be specific here. There is a very specific number. Email us, questions@petesbasement.com. It's definitely not Knob Creek. I hate bourbon. I hate bourbon. Email us, questions@petesbasement.com, entitled Pete's Favorite Whiskey, and I will send you, anyone who gets this answer right, I will send you a free comic book of my choosing. And the fewer people who get it right, the better the comic book's going to be. So there you go. I'm not even drunk yet and I'm making that offer.
So is that 18-year Sean Connery?
Sean Connery is just, he just transcends the sexualities. We should really all aspire to be as good looking when we're 80 as Sean Connery is at any given point in his life.
If you want to really see some sexuality from Sean Connery,
Zardoz speaks to you. The gun is good. The penis is bad. Zardoz, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't even know if you can Netflix that. But just get
I Netflixed it. If you guys have seen that meme with Sean Connery in the red leather, like, bikini bottoms, that is not fake. That is Zardoz.
Zardoz.
Yeah. And just when you think that movie can't get any more trippy and fucked up, it throws you a curveball. Rogue One is apparently going to drop during the Olympics. I've seen the movie. Yes. Everyone needs to see. There are a few movies in this world that everyone needs to see. I understood you meant the trailer for Rogue One. I didn't think you meant Rogue One. I know that's due out in, you know, Christmas. There are very few movies that I believe people really need to see. Zardoz is one of them. I would say The Neverending Story, Caligula. Like, you should probably watch Caligula at the age of like 13 or so. Because that's when I watched it, and I'd like to think it fucked me up just enough in mind to propel me into the upstanding member of society that you see before you every week. Trailer now, Darth Myers says. The new trailer for Rogue One is apparently happening right the motherfuck now.
Oh, man.
Awesome. Yep. Awesome. Let us know how it is. I'll watch it right after this show. So, guys, I was with my boy Age Art, Adrian Velez, and we went down to the Captain America statue dedication ceremony in Brooklyn's Prospect Park, and I gotta say, the ceremony itself was kind of whack. Like, it fucking starts pouring, And they, like, you would think they'd start early. Like, everybody who's everybody is going to be there, like, an hour early. And it's fucking really raining, and they're starting to close shit up. I'm like, are they really going to wait until the whole shit is soaking wet and everybody leaves? Like, waiting for the press to leave before they start this thing? So, finally, they started the damn thing. After the rain slows down a little bit, the sculptor, Dave Cortez, is right in the front. Super nice guy. We had a great interview with him. Look for that on Pete's Basement Extras coming real soon. Before this show hits YouTube, that episode will hit Pete's Basement Extras. Super nice guy. Brooklyn-born guy. So this was like a real big event for him. Very close to home. So he's sitting in the front. And there was just like a lack of organization amongst all of the goings on. They're pulling up the Brooklyn Borough president, who actually said that this was the destination of the Captain America statue, not the dedication. So these are the kind of fucking dumb fucks that we elect as our officials, our public officials. The public faces of Brooklyn is a dumb shit. You heard it here first. The destination of the Captain America statue. I wish I had that shit on film, but we didn't get none of it on film because A, it was raining and I didn't want to pull my camera, my phone out to film it in the rain, and two, all the real press was in the way of everybody. Yo, they had all the fans out, like, you know, behind the little barriers where they had Dave Cortez's family, they had some Marvel representatives and Disney representatives and shit, and that was important. You know, the family of the sculptor was right there in a whole section unto themselves, and that's important. And the press just lines up right in front of them so they can't see shit. Are you fucking kidding me? And they just line up like people haven't been standing here for an hour, and everybody gets in front. From CBS 2 to Channel 11 to Brooklyn's Channel 12 sets up right the fuck in front of us with, Roger, this super duper tripod that I honestly wanted to punch the board in the head and steal the tripod. This was a tripod.
When you see those, do that.
Yeah. This was a tripod of tripods. It had 9 fucking legs, bro. It was a tripod.
Tripod cubed?
Tripod cubed.
No, that wouldn't work.
Try cube pod?
Something like that.
Cubed pod. Just go with cubed pod.
Cubed pod.
Yo, this was the shit. Then when they do the ribbon cutting ceremony, which I figured, alright, this will be real nice to just have like a nice still photo. The press is all gathered around like fucking mice to a piece of cheese, just gathering around. And the fucking broad who was all, like, announcing the whole thing had the audacity to say, okay, everybody gather around so everyone can see. Go fuck yourself. Really? No one could see shit, including the sculptor. They got right in his way. They stood right in his fucking way. Couldn't see dick. He's seen assholes. Literally, there was just assholes bent over in front of him, and he's looking at assholes. The rest of the ceremony, the rest of the, you know, party, whatever you want to call it, the festivities, were absolutely fantastic. There was free water, pretzels, ice cream, and other refreshments for everyone. I was ready to hand the dude $10. I figured, what's the water going to go for in Prospect Park? About $5 a bottle? And the guy's like, no. I was like, really? All right, cool. And I took 2 waters, one for me, one for Age. Cool. They were giving out variant cover signings. We had the writer of Captain America, whose name escapes me at the moment, and Dave Cortez, they were both signing this nifty Captain America variant with the statue in the background and everything. Really awesome. Those were free of charge. They had photo ops with some doofus dressed as Captain America. That was the other thing. Everybody was just waiting there hoping that Chris Evans made an appearance. Didn't happen. They had some doofus in a plastic costume looking stupid. Stupid. I'm sorry. Whoever that was, you're stupid. One of Adrian's friends, and a dude that I actually wound up meeting at the New York Comic Con the previous year, goes by Captain Cosplay on Instagram, and you can find his picture on our Instagram. Yo, he was the best-dressed Captain America there, and he came in with like 2 USO girls. One of them looked like Peggy Carter. I'm sorry, guys, I did not get a picture with the ladies. I should have, but I was stupid. They had, like, face painting for the kids. You could paint the Captain America Frisbee with, like, the little twirl of paint kind of thing. Remember we used to do that in the 80s, Raj?
Oh, yeah.
Like, the rest of the festivities were absolutely fantastic. and a good time was had by all, even with the rain. Spin art, thank you, Edge. Even with the rain, and after it rained, it was hot as balls. Like, it was hotter than Satan's fucking sweaty taint. God damn it. I was so swampy. And I had a very important meeting to get to in the city at 4 o'clock. And I was that dude who took his shirt off on the train. I apologize. I was like, listen, sorry, folks. Took my shirt right off. Put the button-down shirt on that I had pressed between two pieces of cardboard. Just like you would mail a comic book. Had my shirt pressed between the shit. And I buttoned the damn thing down. I was like, okay, that's mildly better. But my hair was all, like, froed out and shit. But, you know, fortunately, the meeting still went very well. It was a great time, nonetheless, despite the heat and the rain and the bullshit. The Captain America statue itself, photos do not do this thing justice. I didn't get a chance to marvel at it when I saw the photos from SDCC, but seeing it in person, the first time I saw it, I was like, wow. Like, it was truly amazing. It's really well sculpted. It's so iconic. It's so well done. And just reading that I'm just a kid from Brooklyn on it, and I know he was born originally in the Lower East Side, and I'm actually not quite certain when that shift came in, when he moved from the Lower East Side to being born in Brooklyn, but I'm pretty confident it was not in Captain America, the First Avenger. I'm pretty sure it happened in the comics before that, but correct me if I'm wrong, please, someone. That was really great. On the other side is a plaque that said, created by Joe Simon and Jack Kirby. The Ultimates, thank you. Ultimate Captain America was born in Brooklyn. Thank you, guys. I should have guessed that myself. Thank you. And it was really great. Just Jack Kirby and Joe Simon immortalized forever. Now, this thing is going to be in Prospect Park for the next 2 weeks. Then it moves to the Barclays Center. Then it goes somewhere else after like a month being at Barclays. I don't remember where it's going after this. It's going somewhere else in Brooklyn. And it hasn't found a permanent home yet. But right to whomever. Sunset what? Sunset Boulevard. Sunset Park. We're just going to move it east and it chases the sun. Sunset Park. There we go. It's moving to Sunset Park after the Barclays Center. I am rooting for it to have a permanent home in front of the Brooklyn Museum of Art. I think that's only fitting because in Philly, that's where the Rocky statue is in front of the Philly Museum. So I think that's where the Captain America statue should be. So write to whomever you think might be listening. Write to Marvel. Write to Disney. Write to Brooklyn Borough President Gumusigyan, whatever his name is, Mr. Designate himself, and tell them that it should go in front of the Brooklyn Museum. Are they going to have the statues at the Sunset Park event? I'm expecting events to be held at both Sunset Park and the Barclays Center. I think they'd be stupid not to do more unveilings because it brings in, you know, brings in a nice public and it's something to, you know, for the media to cover. And I did manage to get this nifty variant cover. Haha, it's mine. Book of the week this week. I have to hand this one to a book, actually, that came out last week that I didn't get a chance to read until this week, which is Action Lab's Blood and Dust, The Life and Undeath of Judd Glenny. And this book is about a family of vampires that are just like living peacefully in a swamp. And unlike, you know, regular vampires who feast on humans, they're feeding on cattle and other animals that run through the swamp and shit. And this old man, Judd Glenny, they call him Grandpa. So he's protecting the townspeople. Every now and then, you know, you get little kids or teenagers or whatever, and they get lost. They go trekking through the swamp and they get lost. And he has a history of going to find these kids and bringing them back safely, and not, you know, eating them or draining them dry. So one guy, a father, comes up to this guy and he's like, I'm looking for the man who saved my son. And he's like, get the fuck out of here. What are you even doing here? And he's like, listen, the townspeople warned me not to come here. And he's like, yeah, you should have fucking listened to them. It's like, what are you doing here? And he's like, I just wanted to say thank you to the man who saved my son. And he starts asking him all these questions. You know, what are you? How did you even do that? Why did you do that? And like the interaction is very hostile at first, and then Judd Glenny kind of warms up, and he's like, you know, I've saved countless amount of kids in my time, and you're the first person who ever came up and said thanks. So you want to know what I am? You want to know who I am? You're going to be sorry you asked. Some questions shouldn't be answered. And he proceeds to tell him who he is and how he came to be and, you know, what's going on with his family. And I don't want to spoil anything for you. This is an awesome story, and it's only one issue long. And basically the prevalent theme is that there are worse things in this swamp than vampires. And you kind of start to realize that this guy is not here as a predator, but he's here as a protector. And although the town is frightened of him, he's like, that's fine, because it keeps most of the townspeople, except for like, you know, a couple of nosy kids, away from the swamp. There are worse things in this swamp. And at the end of the issue, he goes off to fight something. We don't even fucking know what. From Action Lab. This came out last week, and it is the best thing I read this week. It is beyond awesome, and I highly suggest you get it. Action Lab is a very small company, even though they've been out for about 5 years now. I highly suggest that you either tell your local comic shop to start picking this stuff up, or you just get on eBay and you order it. And then you go to your local comic shop and like, look, you should get this. Because the more, you know, little stores that actually order these things, the longer companies like this can stay in business, and the longer we get awesome stories like Blood and Dust, The Life and Undeath of Judd Glenny. I can't remember the last time I read a good horror novel like this. And the last time, Nightworld, I just got finished ordering the graphic novel from Amazon. Last week we had Adam McGovern on, and he wrote Nightworld, which was like a vampire horror story that somehow just slipped under my radar. I don't, you know, I'm up on these things, so kind of dropped the ball there. So I ordered that, and we'll let you know what we think of it after we read it. What did you think of it? You know, really? Yeah? All right, Ramon likes it. Ramon thought it was good shit. So, big Canadian geek. Love that all-star Batman variant. So sexy. Big Canadian geek. Which variant are you talking about? Are you talking about the nifty Midtown Comics variant with Batman and Two-Face? Or are you talking about this, like, boxing variant? That this one actually is my favorite one. I picked up the Midtown one because I do like the artwork, and I like the, you know, it's very kind of, it reminds me of Ed Benes's work, and I like his stuff. But this one, this is just a fucking awesome cover. Batman in like a true boxer's fighting stance is waiting to kick your ass. This is a fucking variant, and this was okay. It was alright. I'm not the biggest fan of John Romita Jr. I don't particularly like his artwork on any character that is not a large, you know, burly creature like the Hulk or Thor or somebody. It's decent on Batman. I don't know. I could have given you other ideas for. I would love, and I reference this guy all the time, but I would love to see an Alex Maleev, Scott Snyder team up on Batman. And if anybody agrees with me, please sound off, because I just think like his work, his style is the perfect combination, especially with Scott Snyder's like writing style to go with Batman. Greg Capullo did a great job, but Scott Snyder, this story was a little odd. And I hate it when stories start like in the middle of it, and then you'll get like 3 or 4 pages in, and then they're like, 2 weeks ago, 3 hours ago, 45 minutes ago. Just tell the fucking story from a linear perspective, please. I hate when you jump into shit, and then you try to give me some cliffhanger like towards the end of the book, and I'm going to spoil this for you because I don't give a fuck. Basically, Batman is transporting Two-Face to some house. You don't know what house, but it's a house of like Harvey Dent's own design that can keep him prisoner. Whatever. And it's taking Harvey Dent and Two-Face from a perspective of complete and utter multiple personality disorder, total schizophrenia. The other personality is aware that it exists, but they don't interact. Like, in the cartoon, which to me is like the definitive Batman forever and ever, amen, Harvey Dent was just, he fucking lost his mind. He flipped out. In this one, it's like he bounces back and forth from Harvey Dent to Two-Face. I don't know if I like that. So Harvey Dent tells Bruce Wayne, listen, I feel him coming back, and he's coming back strong, and he's got a plan, and you need to lock me up, and I've developed this house, and this and that, and it can hold me prisoner. But Two-Face has other ideas. Two-Face apparently has dirt on everyone in Gotham, from crime bosses to cops to everybody. And he promises that if Batman manages to lock him up, all of this dirt's going to become public. So all your trade secrets goes out. All of those fucking dick pics you've been sending to six other girls with your fucking little willy, like, look at that! Look at that! Aren't you fucking wet? No, she's not. No, she's not. No. Just get her a fucking thing of flowers and maybe you'll get laid. Dick pics don't get you anywhere. And fucking all of your other stupid secrets from your bank records to who your fucking real parents are, and all kinds of crazy shit. So he says, stop Batman. Now everybody's a supervillain. Everybody's out gunning for Batman. Ah, it's a cool idea. I hate the format of it where, you know, like I said, we're jumping around from the middle of the book to the middle of the story to the beginning of the story to the beginning to the middle to the beginning. Stop it. Just tell the story in a straight line. And by the look of it, this story is going to go for like a good 6, and I'm being generous, probably 12 issues. He's got Batman has 500 miles to take Two-Face, and this whole book consists of, made it 1 mile. One. Burp. So, the end of it, towards the end, I like that style of storytelling. Well, major reaction, you're entitled to your opinion. I don't personally agree with it, but for me, it kind of makes my brain hurt. Maybe because I drink a lot, and I don't like to think too expandedly. But I just give me a straight line, bro. Straight line. but like somewhere towards the end, and you can throw the cheese down there for you YouTube viewers. I am not... Tarantino's hit or miss with me, bro. He's got a few good ones, and he's got a few that I'm like, eh. But at some point, the bat plane gets shot down, and Batman's talking to Alfred, and he's like, whoever it is, he must be close, he must be listening in. And Alfred's like, I just wanted to tell you, sir, I'm sorry, I had to do it. And it was Alfred that shot the shit down. Like, come on! Come on, it's Alfred. Alfred wouldn't turn against him. I don't care what secrets Alfred has. I don't care if Alfred is fucking blowing Damien, who's fucking 12 years old, in the center of the fucking Batmobile. Alfred would never turn on Bruce. That's ridiculous, Scott Snyder. Ridiculous. And I like Scott Snyder's storytelling. I've liked his Batman run, so I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt and say you're going to clear this shit up, but it needs to be done fast, because Alfred wouldn't do that shit, unless this is all a master plan by Batman in the first place. I don't know, unless somebody's threatening the Robins, in which case maybe Alfred would do it knowing that Bruce could get out of it, and maybe the Robins, whomever they are, whichever one's Tim Drake, Dick Grayson, fucking Damian, that asshole, maybe they're inept and they can't fucking handle the situation. That would be like one of the only reasons that I could see Alfred turning against Batman. Like, someone must be in such grave danger that he has no choice knowing that Batman could get out of it. That's because otherwise, why? Alfred doesn't have any secrets, and the secrets aren't revealed yet. Like, at this point, Batman just kind of kicks ass against some lame-o villains, like the guy that looks like Dynamite's the Spider, that old Golden Age villain, but he's got, like, fucking crazy-ass guns. He fights Firefly and, was it, Killer Moth or some shit? I don't fucking know. You fought him in the NES game. Decent book. Decent start. If you're a huge Batman fan and if you liked the original Snyder Capullo run, obviously I'm going to tell you to pick this up. There's 9,000 variant covers for you to choose from. Please only choose your favorite one. Don't go getting 7,000 of them. You don't need to have all the variant covers because they're not going to go up in value. Variant covers should be made just so you get the art, the cover of the artist you like. You don't have to buy 1,000 of them. And these days, there are way too many variant covers. Harley Quinn last week had easily like 100 because comic shops all over the world had their own variants. Speaking of Batman, what did you think of Gotham on Fox? Bro, I'm not even done with the last season. I'm in like no rush to catch up to it. So I'm like, whatever, I'll catch up to it whenever. Like, I'll get it before the new season starts, but I'm not in any kind of rush. I got a great letter from Omega Prime, who's a Collector Society member. And this is when I feel like we've really made it, is when I'm getting emails and messages from Collectors Board members and, like, Society members. Omega Prime says, been watching your YouTube channel for over a year now, and I enjoy it a lot. And he says, congrats on having Stan sign your AF-15, which I happen to bring down from upstairs in the museum. And there you have it. It's a 3.0. I bought this almost 10 years ago, and I paid just about $2,800 for it, and now it's worth about five times that much. And I did have it signed by Stan. I got to meet him for one of the first times at New York Comic Con, and it was very, very much one of like the highlights of my collecting existence. Omega Prime goes on to say that, you know, in the early 90s, he had picked up a bunch of mid-grade Captain Americas. And a couple of years ago, as he was rebagging and boarding all of his Silver Age stuff, he finds that two of them happen to be signed by none other than Jack the King Kirby. And, you know, he was looking all around for a way to get these signatures certified, and he contacted the Jack Kirby Museum in New York, and they didn't offer any kind of, like, authentication or anything, no kind of services like that. And he says, eventually, the only company who was willing to authenticate them was PGX. To this day, they remain some of my most treasured books. Sometimes it almost feels like the profound impact of guys like Jack Kirby, Gil Kane, Bernie Wrightson, and Steve Ditko have had on the comic world has been forgotten. Omega, I have this to say, like, to the true collector, those people, those guys will never, ever be forgotten. And I can attest to that, and I want to tell you that there is another company, if you're not familiar with it, CBCS does signature authentication. I bought a Hulk number one several years ago from a guy for about $1,100, and I happened to look through to, you know, and on the front inside cover was signed by Jack Kirby. I had no way of authenticating this, besides at the time I had my smartphone, so I looked up Jack Kirby's signature and I just held it next to it, and I'm like, all right, that looks pretty real. So I bought the book. And then I had it signed by Stan, and it got sent to the CGC, and I got a gold label because it was signed by Stan Lee, and there was a little note indicating signed by Jack Kirby, written on first page. Not signed by, written on. So it was just the name Jack Kirby as far as the CGC was concerned. When Steve Barak, who was a former head of the CGC, former head of Heritage Auction Comics, founded the CBCS several years ago, he started doing signature authentication. So when it comes to guys like Jack Kirby, who passed away long before the CGC was even a thing, guys like Steve Ditko, who may have signed books back in the 70s and simply don't do conventions anymore, or other artists who have long passed away, they do signature authentication. And I turned over my Hulk number one and my Amazing Spider-Man number one, which I've had for many, many years. And before I even discovered the glory of the CGC Signature Series, I just brought it to the very first time I ever met Stan Lee at a New York Comic Con. I got there at 6 o'clock in the morning to wait online for 2 hours to get one of 10 tickets to fucking meet Stan and get my Amazing Spider-Man number one signed. And I just had it signed and I was happy. And then when I, you know, I heard about the Signature Series and everything, I'm like, damn, should have did that. So when CBCS came out with their signature authentication, I turned over both my ASM-1, which I obviously knew would get okayed because I watched fucking Stan Lee sign it myself, and I turned over my Hulk number one with my Stan Lee signature, which I was hoping would, you know, obviously come back. and my Jack Kirby signature. So maybe, just maybe, this turned out real. And if it turns out real, it comes back with a red label. If it doesn't, it just comes back to you sealed with, you know, like a green label, I think it is. You know, whatever it is. They couldn't authenticate the signature. But as it turned out, yay me, that's Jack Kirby's signature turned out to be real. And so my Hulk number one sits in a little red label box, just like CGC. CBCS is actually a little bit clearer. And I find a lot of collectors like it better because their turnaround is faster. They haven't suffered the problems that CGC has with the too much pressure on the book that causes that little rainbowing on a side, or sometimes you'll find that the book inside the plastic buckles. CBCS is free of all of that. And the plastic is actually so much clearer. If you hold a CGC book and a CBCS book up next to each other, you will see that the CBCS plastic is so much clearer. Now, I've heard that CGC has cleared up a lot of this problem with their newer stuff, but I mean, you know, people have been getting books graded since, I think the CGC was founded in sometime like 05 or something. So there are books that are, you know, being smished in there. And you don't want to take the risk of taking them out, because what if they're smished beyond repair? Leave them the fuck in there. Don't even try to take them shits out. Leave them the fuck there. So anyway, Omega Prime, turn your books with Jack Kirby's signature over to CBCS. And if you get a chance, Steve Barak is actually at most of the major conventions. He was definitely, I'm sure, in California. You'll see him. He's a short, gray-haired guy with glasses, got a ponytail. Tell him Pete from Pete's Basement sent you. And he knows me. And he's actually a pretty big fan of mine. I'm a big fan of his. He's a super nice dude. He'll be more than happy to talk to you. Just tell him I said hello. And, you know, he'll treat you right. And Omega Prime goes on to say, anyway, really love your show. Your team puts out a really great content, and I'm glad you're a part of the YouTube community. It's really cool to hear an East Coast perspective from someone who really loves comics as much as I do. There was something you said on a past episode some time ago, I can't for the life of me remember what it was, regarding the joy of collecting comics for the joy of collecting, and not just for the grade of the book. This message had a profound impact on my Silver Age collecting going forward. I believe the true meaning of that statement has been nearly lost on the current collecting craze overtaking the industry and the public at large right now. How many variants do we really need of one book? How many guys out there have a YouTube channel devoted to the collection of current variant covers? Who gives a shit? Honestly. Anyway, take care of yourself, keep making great shows, and keep being an original. Mark, aka Omega Prime. Bro, thank you for the kind words. That really, you let him made my day. This is the kind of shit that I really look forward to, and this is the kind of stuff that we really, this is why we set up the Pete's Basement Show in the first place, is to reach out to fans and just create a friendly community where people can talk to each other. And I truly believe that comic collecting has kind of gone by the wayside now, where people are treating them more like stocks, where it's buy, sell, buy, sell, buy, sell. And you drive yourself crazy doing that. You know, you're trying to fucking capitalize on the latest craze, whether it be Suicide Squad or Luke Cage or Doctor Strange or Moon Knight or whatever the fuck it is, Ghost Rider, and you're trying to get these books and then turn them around and sell them, and should I wait to sell them? Should I sell them immediately? What should I do? That's how you go nuts. Don't do that. Don't do that, because you spoil the love that you should have for this industry. Get the books that mean the most to you. Collect the books that you want. Collect the books that of the characters you like. Who cares about the fucking grade? It's about enjoying having the book. You know, I got a fucking 2.0 Amazing Spider-Man. I don't give a shit. I have it. I don't fucking care. You know, I'm thrilled to have it. I seen a dude with a 0.5 Amazing Fantasy 15, and he was showing that shit off on his Instagram, and I liked the image, because you should be proud of that. That's your 0.5, bro. Enjoy it. That's yours. And that's the way collecting should be. Because this is one of the coolest things that we do. And as a nerd, I use that term very loosely. But when other nerds come to your house and you can show off your collection, and then you go to your nerd friend's house and they show off their collections, and maybe you see something you like, you'll be like, oh, I gotta get one of those. That's just one of the best loves that we have in this industry. And that's why I love meeting people from all over the place. And I'm walking down conventions, and people are like, yo, Pete, what's up? And I'm like, bro, how the hell are you? I don't know you, but you know me, so what the fuck is up? How are you? And I'm more than happy to fucking meet people. I love talking to you guys. And I love collecting. And I'm glad you guys too. And I love when you guys share pictures with me. I love seeing old comics and stuff and old toys and shit like that. Like, this, when I saw this at Midtown Comics, Power Master Optimus Prime was one of the first Transformers I ever had. I missed the first wave of Transformers. So I didn't get the original Optimus Prime. I didn't get Bumblebee or Megatron. I had to buy all of them guys separate on eBay. This was one of the first ones I ever got. And when I saw the reissue from the Titans Return, I'm like, shit, I fucking need that. And I plan on taking it out. I'm not going to take it out here because it's really wired in there, like really tight. And I'm not going to waste time on the show to try and do it. But I firmly believe my boy El Sinestro, who runs one of the coolest live-action toy thing, fully articulated comic art, I think it's called, or articulated comic art, something like that. Sinestro, help me out. I'm sorry. I'm getting this wrong.
ACB.
Yeah, you know what I'm talking about.
Articulated comic art.
Articulated comic book art. Is it ACBMA or something like that? ACBA?
Right.
Either way, look up my boy El Sinestro and Toy Addict and all them guys. Articulated Comic Book Art, ACBA. Thank you, Major Reaction. Look up these guys on Instagram. They always got really awesome pictures and they set up their toys because you take your toys out and you play with them. That's what toys are supposed to happen. Now, the only time that I will say that I'm not taking my toys out is very few and far between when the packaging art is that awesome. And Jason Edmiston, I've been following for a while, and then I realized that he was doing these Super 7 artworks for these new Masters of the Universe lines. Midtown Comics did not have Merman, unfortunately, so I'm going to have to eBay his ass. But this is Series 1. They got Series 2 coming with Man-at-Arms and the Sorceress and Trapjaw and Triclops. So I'm going to get those too. And I'm not taking those out of the package because the artwork on the front is just so damn cool that I don't want to damage it. I didn't take my Club of Lang out of its package either because the artwork of Mr. T on the front is so great. And now I got a new Funko Mr. T, B.A. Baracus, coming out real soon. So with any luck, Mr. T will start doing Comic-Con appearances and I can finally meet my 80s idol. Mr. T had such a profound impact on me as an 80s child. Like I loved Mr. T. It was like Mr. T, Hulk Hogan, and a very few, and like Stan Lee. And I didn't know what Stan Lee looked like in the 80s. I just remember watching Spider-Man and the Incredible Hulk on Saturday morning cartoons, and I heard, "This is Stan Lee saying Excelsior, true believer." And I'm like, "I don't know who that guy is, but he's awesome." And then when I figured out who he was. Age Art, the Mr. T cartoon was crazy. I loved it when he taught him and the gymnasts solved crimes. It was great. Loved it. And yes, I did get to meet Hulk Hogan, and he was absolutely awesome. And he told me I looked like a young Sylvester Stallone. So it was pretty fucking cool. Hulk Hogan was the man. So right now, thankfully, like doing Comic Cons and, you know, doing the show and everything, I managed to meet a lot of my favorite, like, celebrities. I met Hulk Hogan. I met Stan Lee. I met Weird Al Yankovic. I met so many people. Jason David Frank is awesome. And we did, like, the stare down pose in the fight. He's intimidating. Like, he's a friendly dude. And then when you tell him, like, yo, can we do a fight pose? Like, he just gives you the stare. Like, he's just gonna kick your ass. And I'm just like, all right. Yeah, no, I'm... Damn, bro. Like, he's got that shit down to a fucking science. Super nice guy. I really want to meet Mr. T, Mike Tyson, who is going to be at, I think it's Comic Craze or something like that, right after New York Comic Con, one of the Stan Lee expos, late October, somewhere in L.A. I really hope that Mike Tyson makes it back to his hometown of New York, because I really want to meet the champ. I really do. And I would really love to meet Chuck Norris as well, in person. And I would really like to do a fight stance with Chuck Norris just to say that I did it. But, yeah. And also, speaking of the CGC boards, my boy Buzzetta hit me up. And he told me, like, yo, bro, they're talking about you on the CGC boards. I said, what? They're talking about me? What the fuck? They see some of your screenshot. So my boy Jam NYC, who apparently is a fan of the show, and Jam, we're happy to have you, bro. He said in reference to Pete's Basement going to the Captain America Expo, the ceremony in Prospect Park, says it's gross out today. Ramon sweats and wipes his brow constantly like a southern preacher in Pete's Basement. If he goes outside today, I'm afraid he'll melt. Fucking laugh my balls off. And my boy Buzzetta says, like, I know Pete personally, I'm texting him this right now. I said, that shit is grass, southern preacher. That's fucking awesome. And Jam NYC goes on to say, that's awesome. They have the best comic book show podcast out there, in my humble opinion. They cover all the new releases without being too Big Two centric. I mostly hate the Big Two now, I gotta be honest with you, with very few exceptions. That's why I stick to, like, Image and fucking Dark Horse and all the miniseries, but that's neither here nor there. I picked up some good books on their recommendations that I probably would have passed on otherwise. Jam, I would love to know which books you've enjoyed thanks to us, because I just love hearing about stuff like that. Pete's got a nice collection of back issues and statues that he mixes in with the new releases. They've got some good creators to come on the show. And in true New York fashion, they drink booze, curse, eat Zeppelis, and talk about Yankee baseball. What's not to like? Bro, I am using that line on our next set of advertising cards, and I'm going to quote you on it. That was one of the best things I read this week, and thank you very, very much. Shit, man, y'all really know how to just get a guy right in the feels, you know? Damn, bro. The Luke Cage trailer. Yeah, this shit was fucking awesome. Luke Cage has been one of my favorite characters for a long, long time. And I was seeking actively a nice copy of his first appearance for a long time. And I got it from my buddy Gary Plattman. You can find him at just about any of the major conventions. He's a, you know, tall guy. He's about 6 foot. Mustache, beard, glasses. Usually has some donuts on his at his table. Just go up, say hi to Gary, tell him Pete DeLuca from Pete's Basement said hello, and I guarantee you Gary will treat you right. I've been dealing with Gary for 25 years, since my grandmother took me to Comic Cons when I was a little kid, bro. I like how Theo Rossi is playing as Shades. I don't know what that statement means, sir. I'm not totally certain. If you're talking about, like, Stranger Things, I haven't watched but one episode yet. Oh, you're talking about the Luke Cage trailer. Probably that. I don't know, like, none of the actors besides Mike Coulter. Burp. Theo Ross, they Ross from Sons of Anarchy. What does that have to do? I'm very confused, gentlemen. I have no idea what's happening right now. Nevertheless, the Luke Cage trailer. Luke Cage has been one of my favorite characters for a long time. Keep drinking! Oh, I intend to. I like Luke Cage, and I didn't really get into Luke too much until, like, the New Avengers, when he started wearing just, like, the bronze t-shirt and the black jeans and the sunglasses and shit. But he was just so cool. Like, the way he carried himself and everything, and he's just fucking awesome. And I wanted that statue, like, the modern Luke Cage, where he's just, like, sitting there with his arms crossed and shit. So after that, I set out to get his first appearance. And now, after watching that last trailer, yo, I don't want to rush summer, because I really love summer, and despite how hot it is, the hotter it is, the more the girls walk around in little low-cut tank tops and short skirts that just seem to blow up in the breeze when there is a breeze. And I love summer, and I don't understand y'all cats that say they don't like summer, because in winter, all that fun stuff is covered up by parkas and stuff, and that's bullshit. Fuck winter. Summer. But I don't want to rush summer, but at the end of summer, we are getting the Luke Cage TV show on Netflix, September 30th. The last trailer, when he's sitting there all smug and the old black dude is talking. I love old black dudes. When they talk, like, it's like, yo, I heard that he, it's like two gangbangers got the shit beat out of him. And Luke Cage is sitting there like, I heard it was four. And the old guy's like, hey. Like, I just, like, something about, like, those old school OG dudes that are just so cool. And, you know, fuck, man, you will never be that cool, ever. As hard as you try, you will never be that cool. I will never be that cool. I would love to just, I've encountered a few of those guys, and I love every time I wind up meeting one of them guys. Like, you know who those guys are? If you ride the subway in New York, sometimes you are fortunate enough to catch these old black dudes doing doo-wops. They're like 50, 60 years old, and they got voices like angels, and they do requests, man. Like, they'll sit there like, yo, does anybody have a song that they want to hear? And I always request, like, one of three songs, whether it's Morse Code of Love, or Little Darlin' happens to be one of my personal favorites, or I actually have asked them to do a Beach Boys song. Little Deuce Coop is also one of my favorites. And yo, these guys can wail these songs, man, in just perfect five-part harmony. And I always throw them like $5 or $10. Like, I don't give money to fucking people on the subway. I don't, because fuck them. What are they doing for me? Like, you walking around begging for goddamn money. These guys are singing, entertaining, and just basically making my morning a much happier place. These guys are all OGs, man. These guys grew up in New York when it was an absolute shithole before the hipster invasion, and they have kept this music alive that you should really, really be listening to. If you were raised correctly, you have heard doo-wops, and you should still be listening to doo-wops. And I saw somebody ask about smoking cigars. I do smoke cigars every now and then. Actually, my boy Tommy Two-Step got me into smoking cigars. I have a couple of them upstairs. I don't like to smoke down here because I got too many collectibles running around. But I go out on a stoop and smoke every now and then. I would love a fucking Cohiba right about now. Cubans are absolutely wonderful. And they're basically like legal again. It's great. Dude, if you got one, smoke it up. Light her up. 451's Neverland, and now that is spelled NVRLND, number one. This is a modern take on the Peter Pan mythos, the Peter Pan legend, where they're punk kids. Peter Pan is like, he's a high school misfit, he's a delinquent, and he's in a rock band that plays at Neverland, Neverland is an underground rave party, and the pirates are these like tattooed tough guys, and the Lost Boys are just like the people in the band, and pixie dust seems to be this drug that people get high on and they believe they can fly, and these fucking people wind up killing themselves right around their 18th birthday. It's a fucked up story. This is a fucked up version of Peter Pan. This is the most fucked up Peter Pan could possibly get. I did not think I was going to like this. When I realized it was Peter Pan, I'm like two pages in, I'm like, the fuck? This is some Peter Pan shit? And as I'm reading it, I get about 5 to 7 pages in, and I'm like, this is some Peter Pan shit. And then by like the 20th page, I'm like, this is some fucking Peter Pan shit. Like, Captain Hook is this tattooed up crazy tattoo artist with a metal arm that he attaches the tattoo gun to his arm and shit, and he's tattooing these broads with pixie dust, and that for some reason like gets them high, makes them want to kill themselves or something before they turn 18, because, like, you know, the idea of Peter Pan was to never grow up. Yo, this is a sick book. And if your local comic shop does not carry 451 books, get your ass on eBay and get Neverland number one. This is like, if you ever watch like any of those like teen shows, like Dawson's fucking Creek or Beverly Hills 90210, or for the younger generation like Victorious or iCarly or something, this is like that on heavy, heavy fucking methamphetamines. This is so fucked up. And it's good. It is good shit, man. Don't you think so, Ramon? Ramon says it's good shit. You need to get a hold of this. I did not think I was going to like this. And it is like my second up for if I had to choose a book of the week for this week, not just the shit that I read this week, but for this week, it's fucking Neverland, and you need to get a hold of it. So damn good. Crazy ass book. I'll tell you one you have to avoid, though. Going back to Action Lab, and that's Blue Hour. I could not get into this book. I found myself struggling through reading it, and it's long, and it's wordy, and I'm like, I don't fucking care. And it's basically like Earth is colonizing other planets, and they're making political deals with other species on other planets, and these like weird looking lizard things with mouths on the end of these little stalks that they got and whatever. And the lizard stalk people don't like the humans, and they're plotting to fucking start a war with the humans, and the humans don't like the fucking lizard people, and they're looking to start a secret war with the lizard people. Everybody fucking hates each other because we're humans and we fucking hate everyone. And it's just like the Blue Hour comes from, like, there's two suns on this planet, and one of the suns sets, that's the yellow sun, and then there's just a blue sun in the sky for like an hour, and that's when all the bad stuff happens. And there's just, I just didn't fucking care. I didn't have an interest in any of the characters. The artwork was flat. Have you ever seen flat artwork? It was decent art, but there was no depth of field in it. Like, the characters were all just standing on the same exact plane. Like, if they were really in real life standing there, they'd be standing on each other's feet. Do you know what I mean, Raj? Like, as another artist, like, when you try to draw characters on a plane in perspective, and there's just a lack of perspective, and everybody just seems to be standing on top of each other, even though there's, you know, the character in the back is in the back, and then there's people in front of him and in front of him. But if you look down at where they land, and they're not actually landing anywhere, they're almost floating on top of each other.
I'm intrigued. I'd like to see it.
It's bothersome. Oh. And it's like, to the layman, maybe it's not so bothersome, but to an artist, to someone who, you know, probably had that problem back in the day in, you know, high school and everything, and who got yelled at by Mr. Frank, one of the greatest cartooning teachers ever to walk the face of the earth, who would yell with his fucking white sorcerer staff and smack that motherfucker right on the top of your desk and say, "What is this, Basura B? Hook it up!" And he would tell you how to, like, he would just, like, get over your shit with tracing paper and just redraw your whole shit for you. And you'd be like, damn, Frank, like, where you hiding that talent in that fucking crazy-ass white fro of yours? But Mr. Frank was one of the, Bob Frank, I believe his name was, one of the best cartooning teachers ever, and I wish I would have listened to him when I had the chance. Mr. Frank, I hope you're watching. I'm sorry. I was an asshole. I was a total asshole. But I the lessons are learned now.
All the rest of those teachers too, because I'm pretty sure that asshole has just kept going.
Yeah, probably. Probably.
Dear teachers, we're sorry.
Dear teachers, we are sorry.
Parents, law enforcement for the most part.
We have some great confirmations from bombs that we dropped from way back, like just almost a year ago, all the way up until like just a couple of weeks ago. Let me just rattle those off, and I want to thank our boy The Shadow for hooking us up with all of this great information. You, sir, are the man. Who knows what evil lurks in the hearts of nerds? Only The Shadow knows. Black Manta is the villain in the Aquaman movie. We told you about that. That is now confirmed. So now if you think back, if you hearken back to that picture of Jason Momoa and Zack Snyder, and there was that weird costume in the background, and everybody was like, is it Nightwing? Is it Black Manta? Blah, blah, blah. Is it fucking Goomzikyam? Is it Kagi, Kago, and Gagamugats? It's fucking Black Manta. And we told you it was Black Manta. And people were like, nah, it's not Black Manta. It's not. Fucking Nightwing. Fuck you assholes, it's Black Manta. Because we told you so. That was my impression of every fucking nerd asshole that ever doubts Pete's Basement. That was pretty much what they'd done. Okay. Yep. So we got Black Manta as the villain in the Aquaman movie. We have Mirror Master recently cast on The Flash. What the fuck was this dude's name? He's got a comic book name. It's like Gray Damon. Am I right on that? I'm making that shit up. No, his name is actually Gray Damon. That is a comic book name if ever I've heard one. Gray Damon has been cast as Mirror Master on The Flash. Now, I do not have a Flash 105, which is the first Mirror Master, which is also the first time The Flash ever arrived in his own comic book. But fortunately, that book is already so high in price that I doubt it's going to go up too much more. So I probably still have an opportunity to buy it. Is he too pretty to play a villain? Probably not, because these days everybody on TV is pretty for the most part. There is someone somewhere that finds everyone on TV pretty. Like, for example, Cisco on The Flash. Now, as a dude, a perfectly heterosexual male, I will tell you if a dude is attractive or not, and I still love tits and pussy, I tell you right now. But, and I'm like, alright, damn, he's a fucking good looking dude. Like, Tyler Hoechlin, he's a decent looking fucking dude for Superman. He's, you know, for TV Superman. Henry Cavill sets the bar entirely fucking too high for us regular human beings. That's just ridiculous. Cisco, like, I don't really wish I looked like Cisco. I wish I looked like Henry Cavill. You know, that therein lies the difference. Somebody just said Patty is fine. Patty Spivot, oh my god, we have confirmation from the Shadow that Patty is making her way back to The Flash. Chantal something or other, I forget what her last name is, she is so hot. She has no tits, but she has just the most amazing ass. Tommy Two Toes, Hugh Jackman sets the ball way too high. You kind of look like Cisco with long hair back in the day. I mean, maybe if I had a real good tan, probably. But, I mean, I know I ain't the most attractive motherfucker on the face of the earth. I don't wish I looked like Cisco. I might inadvertently, accidentally look like Cisco, but I'm talking about the wish factor. I wish I looked like Henry Cavill. I don't think I look like him. I don't accidentally look like Henry Cavill. I'm never mistaken for him. I am, on every now and then, occasionally mistaken for Tom Cruise. I once signed an autograph as Tom Cruise. I shit you not. I had my aviators on, and I was walking past. I just got out of Midtown Comics, and somebody's like, "Oh my god, are you Tom Cruise?" I'm like, "Yes, I am. I swear to you, I signed an autograph."
I didn't know Midtown Comics was across from the Home for the Blind.
I swear to God, on my honor, signed an autograph as Tom Cruise.
Did she fill your face first?
No, she did not. No. Like, where's your sunglasses, Roger? Give me your sunglasses. Come on, give me your sunglasses.
The shiny ones or the black ones?
The whatever you got. Peter's joining the Church of Scientology right now.
Yeah. They're coming for him.
Come on, hurry the fuck up. Give me the sunglasses.
We didn't plan this.
Where did you bury them shits, man?
I got a lot of shit in my bag.
Jesus, they should be on top. You just put them in there.
No, hold on.
Hold on, folks. Roger buried his sunglasses somewhere.
There you go.
All right, whichever you got. I can still fucking catch. That's how I used to catch him when I was young. Second base. It's Tom Cruise, totally.
A young Rocky Balboa.
I like these. You ain't getting them. You ain't getting them back.
$5 for some Chinaman.
Hey, man. Some Chinaman? Yeah. Usually that's me saying that and I get yelled at.
That was for you.
All right.
No, I think that was his name, Russell Chinaman.
Also, Dr. Alchemy is coming to The Flash, and I heard a new rumor from one of my coworkers. My friend Kayla just told me that Dr. Alchemy will be voiced by the same dude that did the voice of the Saw puppet in the Saw movies, so like that crazy ass scary deep voice.
Yeah.
So that's pretty fucking awesome. A young Ralph Macchio. I'll take it, bro.
An old Ralph Macchio.
I met Ralph Macchio, and he's fucking awesome. I met him at a Chiller Con one time. So we got Dr. Alchemy on Flash, and now the Tinkerer has just been cast on Spider-Man Homecoming, and it is not Donald Sutherland. Not Donald Sutherland. Fucking damn it, Whiskey. It is not Donald Glover. This means Donald Glover is probably still open to be the Prowler. And I'm just going to go out on a limb here. It's not as effective without him here. I'm going to go out on a limb here and say that even if Donald Glover does not actually become the Prowler in this movie, that he actually does play Hobie Brown at the very least. That's for you, Ramon. Wherever you are.
Right here.
I truly believe that Donald Glover is Hobie Brown, the Prowler, and they'll set that shit up for, you know, a sequel sometime down the road. We also have confirmation of Obsidian coming to the CW. We bombed that quite a while ago. He's being played by Lance Henriksen. Lance Henriksen of, everything fame. And we have confirmation that Mon-El is actually the dude from the pod in Supergirl. It is officially Mon-El now. So Mon-El is coming to the CW. We told you about that several weeks ago. And just today, Sharon Leal cast as Ms. Martian on Supergirl. Yippee skippy, she's hot. And we're happy to have her. Yay. So, all of those are confirmations, guys. We told you about this weeks and weeks and weeks ago. So, make sure that you go and be the hit at your office water cooler tomorrow. When you tell everybody, yo, I already knew all of that because I watched Pete's Basement. And they're going to be like, what are you talking about? What's Pete's Basement? And then you tell them. And then they go and watch it. And then they're the hit at their office water cooler. Or, like, they encounter different people at the same office water cooler at different times. They stalk the water cooler and wait for different nerds to show up and talk about it. Pete's Basement is good for all the news before it's news. Watch for that hashtag, guys. I'm making it a thing. And we have the Shadow to thank. So, my hat is already off and my drink is in the air. Thank you, Shadow, for hooking us up with all of this fucking information. And it's awesome. If my friends were into fucking comics like I am, I'd drag them here. Then you slap them for not knowing what Pete's Basement is. Yes, Jeff. Yes, you slap them. You slap them hard. And actually, truthfully, you don't even have to slap them. I'll tell you what my father used to do. Whenever I did something stupid, my father was the king of daps. D-A-P. We take first three knuckles on you. On your first three fingers, and we just right onto your forehead. When you did something stupid, like fucking dapped. You get dapped. That's when you like, and your kind of eyes would cross in his weird way. That's when you're like, you weren't like punished, like you didn't get the shit beaten out of you, but you're like, oh, I did fucking something dumb. You get dapped.
That's right, Jeff, all three.
All three knuckles, all three of them. And you gotta be the middle knuckles, the big one, not these little ones here. The middle one, bang, right in the fucking middle. So, Deathstroke Rebirth. First of all, I am fucking happy to have the original Slade Wilson back. And they make a reference to this in the comic book where one of the guys he's talking to says, well, thank God that black-haired voodoo wore off. Yeah, seriously. Like, we got the real Deathstroke, the gray-haired, old dude Deathstroke back. Now, if we just get Lobo back, we'll be really fucking sitting pretty, won't we? We'll be on point, DC, won't we? Deathstroke is back. And we're delving into a little bit of an origin story. We're talking about, like, we're getting flashbacks of when he was just a father with two eyes and he's raising his kids and shit, and he's obviously a hard ass of a father. His son almost, one of his sons almost gets eaten by a bear, and he has to shoot the bear, and he yells at his son for making him shoot the bear. He's like, well, if you weren't such a fucking pussy yelling and screaming, I wouldn't have had to do that. Now I gotta go take care of the cubs because it's fucking cruel to leave them without a mother. And then the next panel you just say blam, blam, blam. And they're like, Dad, what are you doing? I'm fucking shooting the fucking bear cubs because I'm not gonna leave them without a mother because it's fucking cruel because you're a fucking pussy, little bitch. That's how I plan on raising my son. Just like Deathstroke. Damn fucking right. I, for one, am happy to have Deathstroke, the Terminator, back in action. This is some of the shit that I love about DC Rebirth, is it's actually giving us back the characters that we want. And I am enjoying DC Rebirth exponentially more than I ever thought I would. Way more than I have ever, I think, in the history of Pete's Basement, enjoyed any kind of, you know, reboot of a book. Ever. Fuck yeah, Deathstroke's back. And this is like a... this is actually might be the first story in a Rebirth book that seems to continue directly into, like, what is going to be the number one, I'm assuming, is coming out in like 2 weeks. Because this shit doesn't get resolved. He makes a deal with an African warlord to go and kill the Clock King. And the Clock King makes him a further deal and says, listen, the African warlord you just made the deal with is a total asshole, and I've got some dirt on, like, one of your loved ones that is also being held captive, so why don't you spare me, because I don't have too much time left, looks like I got cancer or something, like, Clock King is dying somehow, and, like, you go save him, and I'm going to die anyway, so you get paid 2 ways from Sunday, and you get to kill a lot of people. Fun read. Fun read. And so was
Burp.
Red Hood and the Outlaws. Now, this is a direct continuation of the Rebirth book, one of the other direct continuations, which I think is like the only other one. Basically, the Red Hood is investigating Black Mask and all of his, you know, subterfuge and treachery. He's like becoming the new kingpin of Gotham in the wake of the Penguin and Two-Face being, you know, ousted or whatever. And the Black Mask is not just a black skull anymore. He's more, almost like a machine kind of thing. Like, he's actually, it looks like a human being instead wearing a black skull mask, like a homemade mask, instead of just being like a black red skull looking guy. Like, somehow they just took Marvel shit and just colored it like a gray tone instead. Like, he looks like a guy who made a black skull mask out of things. And this is awesome because he, like, the Red Hood, Jason Todd, is working for the Black Mask. He's, like, undercover as a villain. And he's doing this all to prove to Batman and to himself that he really can be kind of a hero, and he's, you know, trying to tell the Black Mask that, like, listen, I'm not going to kill these guys for you, I'm not going to kill anybody, but I'll work for you, whatever, and he protects this woman, Ma Gunn, who raises, like, orphan boys to be crime lords, like, to work for her crime syndicate, and he was, like, in this orphanage for a short time or something like that. So he goes and saves her. Black Mask is trying to take over her territory. Or rather, she gets out of jail and Black Mask already tells her, like, yo, I'm in charge of your shit, bitch. Like, this... I enjoyed this really a lot. And I like the fact that, being that these are new outlaws, we discussed this in the last episode. This is not Red Arrow or fucking whatever the hell his name is, Arsenal and Starfire. This is Artemis and Bizarro. We haven't even seen Bizarro yet, and we finally see Artemis by the end of this issue. This is Red Hood building a new team of outlaws. And it looks like they're more outlaw-y than the last crew. This is a group of villains who look like they're going to inadvertently do good. Rather than whatever the fuck was going on with the DC New 52 shit, where it just happens to be three heroes who used to work together and now they just call themselves the Outlaws for whatever reason because it sounds cool because they saw the Young Guns movie and they really dug it. Like, whatever the fuck. And they're listening to Bon Jovi's Blaze of Glory, like, in their fucking headphones once a day, like, in the morning when they get up from fucking work and go to get the coffee and shit. And they're like, shut down in a blaze of glory! And that kind of shit. I held my ears so I didn't have to listen to me sing, but you guys did. I'm sorry. But yeah, Red Hood and the Outlaws was fucking awesome. Shaking my head, only you make that connection. Well, Ramon, if you were white, you would have made that fucking connection too, because you didn't listen to white people rock and roll. What can I fucking tell you? Guess who's drizunk? Yes. So last but fucking not least on the DC bullshit is Superwoman. Yeah. Alright. So I'm actually kind of glad Ramon's not here for this because he would have probably flipped some shit. You have the original DC New 52 version of Lois Lane. Not the Lois Lane who is married to the now current version of Superman, but the original New 52 version of Lois Lane, who outed Clark Kent as Superman, and who then died in a battle with some otherworldly being. He went supernova and exploded all over fucking Lois Lane and Lana Lang, like, bah! Just a fucking super cum shot all over the fucking place. And they got superpowers. So Lana Lang became Electro Superman from that horrendous late 90s, early 2000 version of Superman that we'd all prefer to forget, but DC Rebirth makes us remember here. And Lois Lane gets the normal Superman powers of, you know, flight and X-ray vision and super strength and bullshit like that. So, fucking Superman super came Novid all over them and they fucking got superpowers. And now they're running around trying to save Gotham because they don't want fucking Lex Luthor and his new Superman battle armor being the legacy of Clark Kent. I was so bored with this wordy ass book that I struggled to finish it. Even, I can't even recommend this if I wanted to say, like, for a girl to get into comics, like, if you got a daughter to read this or something like that, like, have her read this book because this is Superwoman and Superwoman and two different versions of Superman, like, in the powers of a, you know, with a woman having these powers. You've got Electro Superman. Y'all remember Electro Superman? Do you guys fucking remember Red and Blue Electro Superman? Well, you've got Red Electro Superman, but Electro Superman's powers, and Superwoman having Superman's powers, and it's Lois Lane and Lana Lang, and they're fucking acting like Superman, and it's god-awful, and it's wordy, and it's fucking long, and I swear to God, it gave me brain AIDS reading it, and I'm trying to read it for you guys, and I'm, like, struggling through it, and I finished it, and I'm, like, I hate myself for it, and I kind of want to, like, just cut my fucking wrists because I hate myself, but always remember, across the river if you want attention, up the stream if you're serious. I only wanted to go across the stream after reading this because I only wanted to cry for attention because I realized it was just so stupid and I wanted you guys to know it was stupid. So here I am telling you guys it's so bad. It's just, wow. I hated this book. I hated it. I struggled to get through it. And I did it for you guys because I love you all. You, the Pete's Basement fans, I did it for you. So you don't have to do it. I did it. Stay away from this book. I can't even, like, we have recommended books that are good for girls. You know, like, Ramon and I look at each other, we're like, we can in good conscience read this. Like, whether it was My Little Pony, or Gem, or, what was that, Ghoul Scouts and shit? That was a fun one. There was a couple of good girl books that we read that were really good for, like, coming-of-age teen girls, like, you know, anywhere between, like, ages 10 and 15 or so. If you backtrack, like, just only maybe the last five or so episodes, I know you'll find them, and I can't remember the titles offhand because I'm a little drunk, but I know that we had them, and we recommended them to girls, like, who getting into comics and shit. This is not one of those books. It's not one of them. It's not one of them.
So Jeff says you read for our sins. He's basement read for your sins.
Jeff, you might be my new favorite person today. You really might be. I'm pouring some more whiskey. Because of you.
I want some.
You want some? Well, get your ass on the show and say hello. Come and sit down. Don't sit on the comic book. Sit on Ramon's spot.
Oh, I'm not sitting down. Just give me some.
Well, say hello to the crew.
Hi, crew.
Nope. Lean in more. Lean in. Hey, now you're in. All right. There you go.
Cheers.
Salute.
Salute.
Hi, cameraman. Finally, in terms of comics, we have Marvel's The Accused, which is a Civil War II side story. If you want to hear more about the trial of Hawkeye and when he killed the Incredible Hulk, the fucking defendant is Matt Murdock. And if you want to hear more about that, go read this. Yeah, I didn't think you did. I didn't. Like, I'm tossing through it, and I'm just like, I don't care. Like, I'm reading the core book. I don't care about the side story. And I tried to care about the side story, and I'm like, I don't fucking care. Okay, good. Book's done. So, yeah, that was the whole concept of the book, is if you wanted to hear more about the inner workings of the trial of Hawkeye, this is the book for you. If you are a huge fan of Law and Order, and not even like the good Law and Order with SV, like Law and Order SVU, with fucking Marissa Hardiske, which is, she is so hot. I'm the only one, but she's so fucking hot. But like, if you're a huge Law and Order fan and you like criminal fucking proceedings in the courtroom, this is the book for you. It is not the book for me or regular people. I flipped through this and I got the gist of it and I'm like, alright, I'm good. Accused brought up the Registration Act. Yeah, big fucking hairy deal, Ramon. Fuck you and your Registration Act. That's what I got to say about that. I believe in registration. I do. Tony Stark was right. So, we got a couple of interesting sets of news. Pete likes his comic was less talky, more titty. Always titties. Always titties. Pete's basement, always titties. Always. I like my women the same way. Less talky, more titty. Stop it. If you're not going to talk about Spider-Man or Doctor Who or Batman or something, take your tits out. How fucking difficult is that? I won't say how hard it is because that would really depend on the quality of the titty. Who knows?
This is the part of the show where everyone really comes in handy. They just smack you around and just keep it going.
Yeah, no. Titties and beer! Titties and beer! I don't have beer, but I got whiskey. Titties and whiskey! Titties, whiskey, pizza.
Yeah.
Tits, comics, pizza. That is like, you know how like they say little girls are made of sugar and spice and everything nice? Pete from Pete's Basement is made of titties, comics, and pizza. And that's just the whole thing.
That's like the Pete's Basement Triforce.
Yes. Yes, this needs to happen.
Yes.
This is an illustration that needs to happen. Where we have a little Pete dressed as Link, like, and little titties, and pizza, and comic books, and it's all forms of Triforce, and he's lifting it up.
Yeah.
Where are my artists? Yeah. Where are they? Make this shit happen. We will make you famous on a t-shirt. Triforces, and his titties in the middle, and his pizza in the middle, and his comic books in the middle.
Yep.
There you go.
Sounds good.
So, by the way, this is like a new rumor going around Hollywood, but yo, we will pay you. If the shit comes out good, we will pay you. I'll tell you right now, but...
Ramon will pay you.
I didn't see who said pay me.
It was Age.
Was Age?
Yeah.
All right, well, I was about to say that it's got to be, like, as good or better than Rick Sellers. But, who's like, if anybody could give Rick Sellers a run for his money, it's Age. Because he's good. Like, y'all motherfuckers are good artists. I will tell you that right now. But, yo, we will pay you. Like, I'm not looking for shit for free. I am a graphic artist. I know the fucking struggle. I feel you. I will fucking pay you for your contributions.
Just, you know, really cheap.
Yeah, just draw the shit first, and then we'll talk. So, one rumor going around the Hollywood mill is Jason Momoa is possibly being cast as the Crow. A new Crow movie. I don't know how I feel about this. Only because Jason Momoa is like 6'9". And the Crow is like a scrawny little dude. Like, you know, Brandon Lee was not but like 5'8". You know, Bruce Lee was not a big dude. So his son, naturally, would not be a big dude. You can't have Jason Momoa being like the Crow. Like, I'm not with that. I could be the Crow. Jason Momoa, maybe not so much. But we'll see what happens. Just a rumor mill. We're not sure how official that is. But we do have a fucking crazy-ass bomb from the Shadow this week. This is like nuclear, guys. Like, just... Like, prepare your fucking bomb shelters for this one. Are you ready for this? Are you even fucking... Your brains can't even conceptualize the fucking level of awesome of this fucking bomb from the Shadow. And the amount of repercussions that it might have. Ezra Miller, as the Flash, is slated to meet Grant Gustin as the Flash on this season of The Flash on CW.
Wow.
Are you fucking kidding me? Like, just to have two Flashes encounter each other, interact like that? That sets the stage for so many fucking things. Are you fucking kidding me? If this proves true, if this comes to fruition, this could be one of the most amazing things that the DC TV and entertainment universe ever puts forth. Ever. Because, as we know, Geoff Johns, the new head of DCU, has fully embraced the multiverse. So the idea of two different Flashes, two different Barry Allens meeting, just fucking wow. Just fucking wow. And I'll be the first one to say, like, I didn't like Ezra Miller as the Flash. I did not. Until I saw the Justice League trailer. And then I did, and I'm like, wow. Okay, this kid could really do it. He really could do it. Like, he's fucking awesome. And that brings me to one of our questions. Outbreak 666 asked, do you guys think there's any hope for the DCCU? Personally, I don't. Outbreak, I actually do. I really do. Now that Geoff Johns is in charge of everything, I really have such high hopes for the DC entertainment universe. The cinematic universe. I saw the Justice League trailer and I was fully enthralled. Besides laughing my way through it with Ezra Miller winning me over as the Flash. Everything about it was just so like it was a comic book movie. It felt warm-hearted. It felt welcoming, and which is the opposite of what I think Zack Snyder's movies did. And that was my problem with DC, was they were trying to go too serious and trying to go, you know, just too dark. And that's not, that was not the way to go. I'm sorry. Like, I said it before, Zack Snyder's not a bad director, but he's got to stick to what he does best, and what he does best is not fucking Superman, and it's not the rest of the DCU. I want fun, happy comic book movies. I don't care if they're Marvel or DC or Image or anything else. I want fun, happy comic book movies because I'm watching a comic book movie to escape reality. Reality fucking sucks. Look at the fuck, what the fuck we're dealing with in America, in the world. Are you fucking kidding me? Do you want this carrying over to every aspect of your life? No. I want an escape. I want to be engrossed in a world that is just different and happy and fun and exciting. And oh fuck, there's some crazy world ending shit about to happen, but I've got these heroes who are gonna fucking save me. That's what I fucking want, because I love Captain America and Iron Man and Spider-Man and Batman and Superman and Wonder Woman, and I want them all to fucking save me in the same light. I don't love Marvel more than DC or DC more than Marvel. I just want them all to fucking succeed. And with Geoff Johns being in charge, I really have the faith that it will actually happen for DC. I think Zack Snyder took the wrong road. I really do. I don't think he's a bad director. I just think he was a bad choice for these two movies. I don't think Superman needed a dark turn. A dark, quote-unquote, realistic turn. No. I think Geoff Johns has the right idea. And going forward, I really have high hopes for the DC Entertainment Universe. I really do. And I hope it does good. I want it to do good because in the long run, in the grand scheme of things, once there is one weak link in the chain, this entire world that we nerds have built for ourselves, this fucking utopia that we have come to love of comic book movies 2 and 3 a year, once there is one weak link in the chain, once, whether it's Marvel or DC, it doesn't matter. Once there is one weak fucking link, it all crumbles. It all crumbles down around our fucking ears. And we are back to being the fucking social outcast that we were in the 80s. And I don't want to be that way. Suicide Squad, I haven't seen it yet. I don't know if it's good or bad. I'm hearing such, like, fucking polarized mixed reviews, whether it's good or whether it's horrendous. I don't fucking care. I just want to, I want to see it and I want to enjoy it, and I want to enjoy it. I think there are going to be parts of it I enjoy, and I think there are going to be parts of it that I don't enjoy, and I'm ready for that. But going forward, when it comes to Justice League, the next Batman movie, the next Wonder Woman movie, I think I'm going to enjoy all of them. So yes, I do have high hopes for the DC Cinematic Universe. Fingers fucking crossed, bro. Let's see, what are the questions we have on Instagram? Jorge Burgos asked, are you guys disappointed at the fact Ghostbusters failed at the box office? No, I'm not disappointed. I got what I expected. You got a movie that paid no attention to its original fan base, and some twerp of a fucking Hollywood director thought he was going to make Bridesmaids 2 in the form of Ghostbusters. And that failed. Big fucking surprise. If you did Ghostbusters 2 with an all-female cast, with respect to the what came before you, with respect to the fan base that was built before you got a hold of this movie, whether you made them interns or students or daughters or whatever, if you built this movie on the grounds of the first two that were set in front of you, this would have been a success. Instead, this little twerp of a fucking nobody thought he was fucking somebody, and he fucking made a movie that nobody gave a fuck about because he wanted to make his own way, and he had no respect for what came before it, and he had the audacity to fucking chastise everyone who said some bullshit negative thing about it as being misogynistic or whatever else against women, and that was not the fucking case. People who said shit against this movie were not misogynistic against women. They were against the fact that you paid no fucking attention, credence, or fucking respect to what came before you. And this director is a fucking idiot. He's a twerp, and he deserves to get jumped in the fucking East Village and beaten the shit out of and robbed and fucking left in his underwear in the middle of fucking Harlem. That's what should happen to this guy. I'm sorry.
I forgot who asked, but they said, is it worth seeing in the movies?
No, it's not worth fucking seeing in the movies.
Here's my answer to that question. I think that it's better to see it in the movies because the best parts about it were just, they did a spectacular job at some of the visuals, and it won't come across in the DVD. It's going to be worth, like, it's nice to see it in 3D. It's nice to see, like, the Ghostbuster shit in 3D and, like, the beams and stuff like that was kind of cool. You know, I mean, there were some funny parts and whatever, but ultimately, I think all of that's going to be lost, like, on a DVD and a flat screen.
And it's a shame, because I like the, for the most part, the female actors that were involved in this movie. I do, and I think they get a bad rap for making a movie that was poorly conceived.
Some of the Ghostbusters tech was cool, like, the upgrades and some of the stuff.
You know, the gauntlets and shit, like, right. I like it. Yeah. I do. There were definitely parts of this movie I could have liked.
Like, they talk about, like, oh, well, everybody else made appearances in it, and, like, if you looked at, you know, what's his name, Ray Stans.
Uh-huh.
If you looked him in the eye, he looked like he was being, like, held down. he had that look of, like, why am I doing this? I can't believe I'm doing
You saw it, right, Raj?
I did see it.
Okay.
I have to write up my opinions on it.
You really do. I would enjoy hearing about that, as would the rest of our fans.
Yeah.
Josh Krieg said, if you had any comic book character to make you a meal, who would you pick and what food do you think they would make? All right. The only guy that comes to mind is the Blob, because he's fat. Like, I trust fat guys to cook for me. I do not trust skinny chefs. I see these motherfuckers on TV, and y'all act like y'all can cook. I don't fucking trust you. I don't, because you're skinny. And y'all don't eat the things that you make, because you're skinny. If you eat the things that you make and they're that delicious, you're going to eat a lot of it and you're going to be fat. So I don't trust no skinny chef. So I'm going to wait for a fat chef. And I want the Blob to make me my favorite dish, which is simply a pepperoni pizza with extra cheese as an appetizer. And some regular old macaronis, spaghettis, with all sorts of seafood on top of it.
Nice.
Clams, mussels, lobster tails, shrimps, scallops if they're fresh, scungeel if it's fresh. That's what I want the Blob to make for me. Because I believe if anybody could make it, it's a fat guy. That's what he's there for. Because he's going to taste it. Nah, this ain't right yet. He's a little more red pepper. Nah, he's a little more oregano. You ever see Fatso with Dom DeLuise when he's making a gravy and he's got the bread and then the scene flashes and he's down fucking four loaves of bread and three pots of gravy? That is what I'm waiting for out of a chef. That is a chef, folks. That. All right, GG Tunline NC. I hope, I don't know if I'm even saying that name right. It's GG Tun, T-O-N, Line NC. What is your favorite item from your collection, comic and toy? Alright, brother, I will tell you right now that despite all of the comic books that I have, and that includes a showcase number 4 signed by Carmine Infantino, one of only two that I know of in existence. One of them is a .5 and I have a 2.5, so fuck you. My favorite is my Amazing Fantasy 15 3.0 signed by Stan Lee. And my favorite toy, right behind me, just happens to be my Voltron on the bottom there. I pulled it out a couple of weeks ago, and it is mint condition. I bought that shit in mint in box, and I took it out of the box because toys deserve to be played with, and I put it together. I still have the box. The box is in a closet somewhere, but one of my favorite toys to this day, and it is still movable and, you know, posable and everything, though I don't play with it. I am looking forward to getting that new Voltron that they came out with. That's like $400, but it's all like fully posable and shit. How they managed to get fully transformable, creatable for Voltron, and then it moves on its own and everything, I don't know how they do it, but I plan on finding out. That shit is awesome. GT, great question. I do love talking about my own collection and stuff, and, you know, being able to nerd out with you guys. Is Prado, IS Prado, thoughts on Hot Rod's new look for the Transformers movie? Hot Rod should be more red than black. I don't know why he's all black. He should be red with yellow highlights, not black with red highlights. I hate the new look. For what I assume is going to be made into Rodimus Prime by possibly the end of the movie, and fuck you, Michael Bay, if you go this route. I don't believe that the general audience is ready for the death of Optimus Prime for the fourth time or third time, whatever the fuck it is. Nobody cares anymore with the fucking Transformers movies. But it... you should have patterned the whole thing off of the 1986 movie. This was the 30th anniversary this past week. And if you wanted to make a Transformers movie, the whole shit was lined up for you right there in the script 30 years ago. Make the Transformers movie into live action. You want to make a hit movie? Here it is. It's animated for you. Every scene is done. You, as a director, get to fucking sit back and smoke a bowl while everybody does the work for you. The work is done, bro. Make Transformers the movie into live action and the people would have eaten it up. Instead, you want to make your own dumb shit, and guess what? It's gonna fail. Just like the last movie. How many people actually enjoyed the Mark Wahlberg fucking movie? Nobody. Do you know how many people enjoyed that? They liked it for 5 minutes when Optimus Prime was actually just a flat-nosed fucking semi, just like he was always. That's the only part that anybody liked. Anybody. The rest of it, you suck. And you took the fault of sucking. Galvatron? Really? Is a fucking another truck of Megatron? You should be fucking hung by your own taint. Yes. They should rip out your taint, wrap it around your neck, and hang it from the nearest pedestal. Vegetable Tube, what if Deadpool movie cast Cable as a woman? Who would you cast? Who is the fucking broad from Glee that played the, like, manly gym teacher? Whatever that broad's name is, she's Cable. I don't know who she is, but she's Cable. Doc Myers said Moss Man versus Swamp Thing would be a good one. I'm gonna give that to Swamp Thing, actually. Just because Moss Man always seemed like kind of a... like, he was always depicted in the comics as, like, kind of this ancient being, but he was kind of a pussy. Like, he just seemed like he was a pushover to King Hiss and the rest of them crew. I think Swamp Thing would whoop his ass, bro. I really do. I think Swamp Thing would fucking kick his lily livid ass. Wow. Also, want to thank the Bagging and Boarding Bad Boy for always following us on YouTube. He said recently, it's been busy with life, but catching up on Pete's Basement, never miss an episode. Bro, thank you for always watching. I want to apologize for the hours upon hours of life that you have missed out on from watching our show. Sorry, you'll never get those back, but we appreciate it. We highly do. We love having you. We really do. And that's about it. What else we got? I think that's about it. Guys, thank you for tuning in. It's been a great ride. This has been my very first Pete solo episode. So, please hit us up and let me know what you thought of the first Pete solo episode of Pete's Basement. Questions at Pete'sBasement.com, Facebook.com/Pete's Basement. Follow us on Instagram and Twitter and Tumblr and fucking Pinterest and all those other oddball sites at Pete's Basement. And if you have an opportunity, check out Patreon.com/Pete's Basement. And if you have some money to spare, feel free to donate to Pete's Basement. We have plenty of crazy cool prizes on the right-hand side for you to choose from. And if you don't see something you like and there's something that you want, hit us up at questions@petesbasement.com and let us know. And we will make a prize for you because we're cool like that. I mean, most of the time right now, the prizes include drawings from me or Roger or free comic books and stuff like that. But you never know what we can.
Voicemail message for you.
We can make a voicemail message for you. We can hang out and fucking have voicemail chats, like, you know, fucking video phone chats, like it's the Jetsons for like a half hour or whatever. The Batcave treatment is one of the top ones. Where we'll pick your ass up from the airport, put a blank, you know, fucking blindfold over your head and drive you around so you're lost, and then, you know, drop you off in Pete's Basement so you're on the show, and then we'll fucking roughhouse you and, you know, we'll kick you in the stomach and fucking tie you up, and
we'll get you some pizza.
Get you some pizza, but we're gonna drop you off in like the middle of Harlem in the fucking middle of the night, and, you know, you're not gonna know where you are, and you'll be like, alright, see you later.
Deuces. Harlem.
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, it'll be good.
But you know you're home. So guys, thanks for tuning in, as always, and we will see you next week. Guys, by the way,
This is it. This is the thing.
This is the time. This is when you should really turn up the volume and pay the fuck attention. This is when we start giving away 2 3-day passes to New York Comic Con. Are you ready for this? Are you fucking ready for this right now? So this contest is going to run until September 8th at like 8 p.m. because we have to get your names, the winners' names, in to Read Pop by like end of day.
Like end of business day. It's probably September 7th.
September 7th? So we're going to do like a
11:59.
So we're going to do like a little mini video or something where we draw the shit. We'll draw the name out.
The end will be 11:59 September 7th.
So,
and we'll do the actual drawing on the air the next day.
Looks like September 7th is your last day to enter. And we're going to announce the winner on September 8th. So September 7th is your last day to enter. We're going to do this contest officially. Like officially official through Rafflecopter. So when you look on the PeachBasement.com homepage, in the upper corner, right there in the right, you will see New York Comic Con tickets. You click on that, and you'll be able to enter the contest through the various ways that Rafflecopter allows you to enter the contest, from sharing it on Facebook, sharing it on Twitter, sharing it on Instagram, all of which is worth 1 point each. And you can do this multiple times over the course of the several weeks. In fact, you can do this once a day on each of the social medias. So if you share the post for, you know, winning Pete's Basement New York Comic Con tickets once a day on Facebook, on Instagram, on Twitter, on everything else, each one nets you one a day. That's possibly 5, 6 or whatever, you know, potential entries per day that you could share. There is also a trivia question.
We'll do one a week.
We're going to do a trivia question per week?
Yes.
We are going to do a trivia question per week, says Roger.
And each of those, answered correctly, will get you multiple entries.
We'll get you multiple 5 entries into the contest. 5 entries into the contest. Are you reading me correctly? So if you answer the first question correctly, you will get 5 entries. So, the first question, are you ready? This is for Pete's Basement fans. When was the very first episode of Pete's Basement? When was the very first episode of Pete's Basement? Now, if you've never been watching until right now, this is pretty easily Googleable. It's Googleable. It's a thing. Googleable, guys. It's a hashtag. It's a thing I've made up. It's Googleable. You can search this through Google. If it is searchable through Google, it is what? It is Googleable. You can search this. When was the first episode of Pete's Basement? Correct answer nets you 5 entries. Every day that you share this post nets you an extra entry into every social media that you share it upon. Twitter, Facebook, Tumblr, fucking Pinterest, fucking Google Plus, everything. Whatever, if you can fucking dream it up, you get an entry.
Maybe not Google Plus.
Maybe not Google Plus.
But PeteSpace.com/NYCC16 will have all the information and the entry form that you have to fill out. You can't just do this. You have to fill out the entry form once you do it.
Are you listening to Roger?
You have to say it again because they can't hear you here.
I heard Roger, but I'm not sure if you heard him or not. PeteSbasement.com/NYCC16 entry form, right?
No, it's NYCC16.
Come on, come on, come over here. Come over here. Guys, please, welcome our esteemed director, Roger, onto the program. Roger, welcome to the program.
I don't even know if I'm going to be recorded on this thing.
Here's what you're going to do. You're going to sit right next to me.
No, I'll be right back to you right here.
You're going
to
come next to me?
Yeah, because this is the mic.
Ho, Johnny.
Yeah.
Hi.
Hi. How you doing?
Hi.
It's kind of like you got,
hi,
you know, attach the second head to your shoulder right here. PeteSpace.com/NYCC16. We'll have the entry form, the rules, everything you need to know to enter the contest. You can't just share this stuff. I mean, thank you for sharing because we appreciate that. But in order to actually count that, you have to go to PeteSpace.com/NYCC16 and actually fill out the entry form so that we can keep track of who is entering the contest and thus fairly attribute you the points you deserve to win the tickets. Right? Make sense?
So essentially what Rudge is saying is he's going to take over most of the, you know, responsibility of, you know,
telling you, because
taking Pete care has, of this contest.
This was full, and it's not, well, Pete's,
I didn't
done
even
worse.
Drink that much. He's I've been worse.
He's done worse for sure, but still.
But I didn't have a big dinner.
You know, our very, you know, the guy who normally stops Pete from drinking way too much is not here today. Thanks, Ramon. So, and I'm behind the camera, so I can just look concerned at him, but I can't actually stop him from drinking. So,
I can't.
There's nothing I can do. Yeah. All right. So that's the deal. You want to win these tickets? PeteSpacer.com/NYCC16. That's the URL to go check out all the information on how to enter. You'll have the entry form. You have to answer the question, right? And the question was?
New question every week, but right now the question is,
when was the very first episode of Pete's Basement? Answer that question into the entry form. You get 5 points. Sharing and all the other stuff will get you 1 point. Check out the information on the website and you'll have the official rules. Don't take it from Drunk Pete. Drunk Pete is not officially legally binding.
Nothing.
Thank God. And now I will leave you to Drunk Pete.
That's why I have Roger. Guys, thank you for tuning in. As always, we love to hear from you guys. And we will see you next week. Have a good one. I am out of whiskey. I gotta pour myself a whole new glass of whiskey just to say goodbye to you guys. I do.
If only there was some song you could sing to say goodbye.
Well, I can write some really sad music.
No, I'm not gonna play no sad music. You don't drink whiskey to be fucking sad. You drink whiskey to be fucking happy because life makes you sad.
That's
don't
true.
The fuck.
I agree. Life makes you sad. That's true.
All I gotta tell you guys is a quote that I got from David Allan Coe. And who the fuck knows who else was singing this song, but how do you spell relief? I get D-R-U-N-K. See you next week.
Bye, everybody. Hey, Paris.
Pete's Basement is copyright 2015, Ripped Productions, and Pete's Basement, LLC. All rights reserved, so go fuck yourself.
What's up, everybody? This is the first solo Pete show. Just give me a moment to sign into the old scoperific here. I keep trying to sign into Pandora. I keep just... Periscope should have a P, goddammit. That's the thing.
A P, goddammit.
Oh, I'm the asshole! Absolute. I am by myself because everyone fucking sucks. Everyone sucks. I fucking... Ramon is sick. Ramon's got fucking bronchitis. Who the fuck gets bronchitis in the goddamn summer? First of all, who gets fucking bronchitis in the summer? He couldn't come to Captain America yesterday because he was fucking sick with bronchitis. I think he was sick with too fucking hot in the basement-itis. But guess what? We got the fucking fans on, bro. The fucking fans are on. Because the microphone is just aimed at me. The microphone is aimed here, so it's not picking up all of that, or that, or that. The fans are on. You missed it. And everybody else I reached out to, all of my other friends. Everyone's out of state today. Fucking Cheeseburger is upstate, still on tour in Syracuse. Rich is God knows where. Wouldn't be back till like 11:30 or some shit like that. Greg is camping. Demetrios is in Chicago a week early for the Wizard World out there. Wish I was there. Everybody in a Craddock, genius rocket scientist and newly crowned black belt, Chris Craddock. By the way, Chris, congratulations. Chris is in Utah selling rockets. Everybody's gone. So here we are in the world's first Pete only Pete's Basement. It's like 105. Whether people have been experimenting with this new feel-like temperature. You see this shit on the news? Yeah. Now, like we have the wind chill. Now we have the feel-like temperature for the summer. So it's 95, but it feels like 105. Yeah. Guess what? If it feels like 105, it's a fucking 105. Pete's tits were sweating. One of the best lines I ever heard was, you know you're a true New Yorker when the breeze from an oncoming subway train is a refreshing change.
Oh yeah.
What's my fucking motivation, Pandora? I'm gonna pay you $8 to just not hear ads anymore?
Right.
You guys can all suck a fucking tiger's dick. If we have any Pete's Basement fans that are actually secretly lizard people from the Hollow Earth Society, please come kidnap me.
No.
Who the fuck just tuned in and it's reptile people talk? That's gotta be Ramon. Well, motherfucker, you are an hour and 10 minutes late, so bite me.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're talking about reptiles. We're talking about reptile people and kidnapping children and kids taste like eggs.
See what happens when you don't come to the show?
Seriously.
See what happens?
Do you not fucking see the madness? I'm like six shots in. I have a gallon of whiskey in front of me. This is your fault, Ramon. Your fault. By the way, the fan's on, dick.
Yeah.
I will slap my nuts on pineapple pizza. I will do that. I will do that. And we'll see who eats it then.